I think doing this project in Rio came directly from Diane. It was something that she wanted to do as soon as we played here last year and played these beautiful shows. The people, the other musicians that we met, the public, the incredible landscape was just kind of intoxicating to her, and she was blown away.
I grew up with people singing around me all the time. At home, my grandparents, we all sang. We sang in church together, we sang, and it seems like people just don't sing anymore when they go to people's houses. I mean, it was such, I used to think that everybody's grandparents loved jazz and had a piano and played and spent their Sunday evenings after Sunday roast playing and singing together and the piano or whatever instrument we could pick up. My dad's side of the family was totally immersed in music and jazz music, like especially Fats Waller and old traditional New Orleans songs. I was surrounded by 78 records, old magazines, old sheet music, old newspapers, comedy from the, you know, greatest comedy ever made, and did not know what the hell I was going to do with it.
1, 2, 3, 4, yeah, Jack Benny.
When I was 16, I started to listen to Monty Alexander, great jazz pianist, and his band members were John Clayton and Jeff Hamilton, so I'd play along with his records. When I was 19, I met Jeff Hamilton at a jazz band camp in Port Townsend, Washington.
And she came there predominantly to find out how the Monty Alexander Trio worked. That was one of her favorite records. And John Clayton and I were on that record from Montreux. And she asked a lot of great questions. And I heard her play the first time. And I said, she didn't sing. She's only a jazz piano player. And I said, you can do whatever you want to do. Who do you want to study with? Because you have so much talent.
So as time went on, she studied in Los Angeles. I know that I did. I can't remember if we ever did any trio gigs together, but I sometimes would go to duo gigs with her and just to support her, knowing that she was that eager to be a jazz musician, to dedicate her life to this music that we love. And like they say, the rest is history. She just took off. She opened her mouth at some point, and we discovered that she could sing as well. Put it all together, and you have Diana Krall.
Let's fall in love. Why shouldn't we fall in love? Now is the time for it while we're young. Let's fall in love. Let's fall in love. Let's fall in love.
It's kind of like watching your little sister do well, and you're so proud of her because she hasn't really changed. She's still the piano student at that jazz camp.
It is very different than Vancouver, but the mountains and the sea and the ocean, and that's where I want to be, you know. I could sing that and be either here in Rio, or I could be in home, driving home from the airport in Vancouver. I was reading about the origins of bossa nova, and there was a Frank Sinatra fan club here in a Dick Farney fan club, and the love of standards of the musicians here in Brazil, it started very early, and the marriage of bossa nova and standards I think works very well. You know, I'm not comparing it to opera, but I'm comparing it to a very passionate sensual art form, very different than opera, but when you go to the opera, you really don't need to know exactly what they're talking about. You feel it. And I think that's what I feel when I listen to bossa nova and when I listen to João Gilberto or Tom Jobim, is the feeling.
I think that not only is Diana's voice right for singing bossa nova, but I think also her piano playing is always right on the money. It's an extension of her singing, and her singing is very sensitive and very sexy which of course the bossa nova suggests, but then when she goes into a piano solo, listen to her single lines, you know, then she really puts on the bossa nova style pianistically, as opposed to the other kind of piano playing that she can do, which is very full and two-fisted and not appropriate for what the bossa nova suggests. So I really admire what she's done that way too.
I think with bossa nova and the music of Jobim, what I've heard in, well, what I've experienced myself in performing here, with everybody singing with us, The Girl from Ipanema in the language it was originally written. And that was a very moving experience. I turned to John Clayton, I saw that he had tears running down his face, and he just couldn't believe it either, because it was such a collective experience of people singing. And that's something that really, really moved me, to do The Girl from Ipanema, to do Quiet Nights, to do these Brazilian songs. But each day he walks to the sea, he looks for a love.
Great songs are great songs, but not everybody can sing every great song. So what makes Diana's process unique, she's found a personal connection to every song that we're playing.
I see my mom and myself, and I want to give my kids all the great things I had growing up. And it's just all such a great time for me right now in my life. I'm the happiest I've ever been. And coming out of a difficult time with the loss of my mom and Rosemary Clooney and Ray Brown, I'm not looking back, I'm looking forward. And it's just really, really fun and great right now.